This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can enjoy inspired biblical teaching. You can visit gbcweb.tv on the internet, watch a range of Christian videos, and download them as audio podcasts to your MP3 player or PC, or order video DVDs and audio CDs for personal or church use. Let My People Go, Exodus 5 verse 1 to 6 verse 27, by Pastor David Wise.
When the Word of God arrives in our hearts and lives, testings and trials come too, as God's appointed way for His children to grow. When God calls us, when God blesses us, when God gives us faith for a situation, there are always going to be difficulties following. And we come to part 5 of this series today. Just to remind you, for those of you who are here for the first time, as part of this series, the book of Exodus in the Old Testament, and if you're looking for the passage today, you'll find it on page 61 in the Bibles that we use here. The book of Exodus and the events in it are probably the most significant part of the Old Testament. And it's foundational to everything that follows in the Old Testament, and in fact also to much of the New, as we will see as we work through. Now, some parts of the story are really well known. There can't be very many people who've never heard of the plagues, the parting of the Red Sea, or the Passover, these giving of the Ten Commandments. These are events that in most cultures people have come to hear about and know about. But many people, including many Christians, don't understand the significance of these events for themselves today. So as we work through the book of Exodus, we're going to be looking at that very closely, moving between then and now, and asking the question, what does this mean for us today? And we're going to be doing that as we walk through this passage this morning. So last time we left Moses and Aaron having just arrived back in Egypt. It's been a real struggle. 40 years have elapsed since Moses was in Egypt last. You may recall he left under sorry circumstances, having lost the plot and killed somebody. 40 years he's been off in the wilderness. God calls him, sends him back to Egypt. Was he keen to come back? You need to respond. You need to wait. Was he keen to come back?
No.
He raised every sort of objection. When he'd finished his objections, do you remember what he said to God?
Send somebody else.
But finally he'd agreed to go. And so there he is, back in Egypt. And we left him last time. He'd had a meeting with all the elders of the Israelites. Just read the tale of chapter 4. Moses and Aaron brought together all the elders of the Israelites, and Aaron told them everything the Lord had said to Moses. He also performed the signs before the people, and they believed. And when they heard that the Lord was concerned about them and had seen their misery, they bowed down and worshipped. Now, I want to note a phrase, because I'm going to come back to it later on. Verse 30 says very clearly this: Aaron told them everything the Lord had said to Moses. How much?
Everything.
I want you to hold on to that, because we need to come back to that in a few minutes' time. So we come now to this first confrontation between Moses and Pharaoh. Chapter 5, verse 1. Afterwards, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and said, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Let my people go, so that they may hold a festival to me in the desert." Anybody notice anything odd about that? Go back with me to Exodus chapter 3 and verse 18 and see how many odd things you can spot. Well, we'll listen to you. Okay, he's spoken to the elders of Israel. We've just seen that. Then you and who?
And the elders.
you and the elders are to go to the king of Egypt, and you're to say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has met with us. Let us take a three-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. Anything strike you? Comparing chapter 5, verse 1 with Exodus 3, verse 18? Timmy? A slight dose of disobedience. That is an understatement, Timmy. A total disobedience. I mean, he did go and see Pharaoh, that's true. He failed to take the elders of Israel with him. That's clear. Take the elders with you. Did he take them? No, he went on his own. He used different words to address Pharaoh. He used words that Pharaoh wouldn't have understood. Who's the God of the Israelites? Pharaoh wouldn't have understood that. God of the Hebrews, that he would have understood. And he makes this authoritarian demand. Let my people go. What did God say? God said, go and ask Pharaoh, let us take a three-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. Moses comes along and says, God says, let my people go. That is God's ultimate agenda, but that was not what God told Moses to do. And so he ends up without the Israelite leaders, making an authoritarian demand. Do you notice the difference in tone between what God tells him to do, which is courteous, respectful, and gracious, and what Moses does, which is confrontational, authoritarian demand, using terms that Pharaoh would not have understood? Why do you think Moses did that? What happened between chapter 3, verse 18, these very clear, straightforward instructions, and him arriving before Pharaoh? You won't find the answer on the text in the Bible. You're going to have to use your imaginations and think for a moment. Because it's something that sometimes happens to us. Use our experience. Yes, Isaiah. So he got distracted.
Yeah.
Got distracted, so he just went ahead and said what he said. Yeah? Okay, what else? Timmy?
He's become more assured of his calling. And sometimes when that happens, we tend to kind of do our own thing.
Ah, so he's got more assurance of his calling, and so there's come with that an arrogance. Just doing his own thing. God's called me to do this. I'm the Superman here, so I'll just do it. Yeah? Anita?
Doing it in an authoritative way, different way to the way God told him to do it.
Yeah, he's doing it a very authoritarian way. God said gracious and courteous. Moses comes in, whack. Mangina?
He knows what the end is going to be, therefore he doesn't want to wait all this time.
Very good. He knows the end of the story, but he's forgotten what God said to him about the middle bit. Go back to chapter 3, verse 19. I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. So I will stretch out my hand. I will strike the Egyptians with all the wonders that I will perform among them. After that, he will let you go. You see, he's got his eye on the end. But he's forgotten that to get from here to there is a journey. And Moses wants the shortcut. Moses wants the instant result. Does that sound familiar? Moses wants it like yesterday. God says, this is tomorrow. There's a journey from here to there. Moses says, I'll have it now. I'll claim it now. That wasn't God's will. That wasn't God's purpose at all. Sound familiar? Let's look at Pharaoh's response, verse 2. Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey him and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord. I will not let Israel go. Then they said, the God of the Hebrews, better, has met with us. Now let us take a three-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. Better. or he will strike us with plagues or with the sword. God didn't say that. The king of Egypt said, Moses and Aaron, why are you taking the people away from their labor? Get back to your work. Then Pharaoh said, look, the people of the land are now numerous and you are stopping them from working. You see, he gets back on the plot a little bit, but then he loses it. He thinks, Pharaoh's not going to listen to me, so let's throw in a threat here. You know. You've got to let us do this, or God's going to do all this to us. God hasn't said that at all. Pharaoh's response is typical, absolutely typical of a tyrant. This phrase he uses here, the people of the land, actually was a derogatory phrase. And so he's saying, you know, these rubbish people, these rubbish people. They're numerous. You stop them from working. I'm not going to draw it out a great deal today or in the coming weeks, but for reasons that ought to be fairly obvious by now and will become clear as we go through, this passage is taken by many oppressed people to be God's word to them. And many people have seen, many groups of people, have seen in this a pattern for God's liberation for them. And sometimes people have actually taken this passage here and they've interpreted it in a very political way. And it's become mixed in with Marxist ideology and come mixed in with violent revolution. In fact, one of the commentaries that I'm using in preparation for this takes that line. It sees this as being a mandate for revolution, for rising up against the powers that be, for the working class to be set free as they rise up against the oppressive upper classes and the bourgeoisie and overthrow the powers and all of that. And there is elements of that, of truth, of God wanting liberation for people. But actually, when you start using particularly a Marxist interpretation to interpret the text here, it changes what it means in ways that actually alter it out of all recognition to its original context. But it is true, there are many trodden down peoples who have used this passage to understand God's care for them and to understand that God wants to liberate them and set them free. And there are some wonderful examples of that in history. And we might refer to some of those later on in the series. Let's go on, verse 6. Not going so well for Moses at the moment. But it's going to get worse. That same day, Pharaoh gave this order to the slave drivers and foremen in charge of the people. Just to make it clear, the slave drivers were Egyptians. The foremen were Hebrews. They were Israelites. They were collaborators. That's significant for reasons you'll see as we go through. You are no longer to supply the people with straw for making bricks. Let them go and gather their own straw, but require them to make the same number of bricks as before. Don't reduce the quota. They are lazy. That's why they're crying out, let us go and sacrifice to our God. Make the work harder for the men, so they will keep working and pay no attention to lies. Then the slave drivers and the foreman went out and said to the people, this is what Pharaoh says, I will not give you any more straw. Go and find your own straw wherever you can find it, but your work will not be reduced at all. So the people scattered all over Egypt to gather stubble for straw. The slave drivers kept pressing them, saying, complete the work required of you for each day, just as when you had straw. The Israelite foremen appointed by Pharaoh's slave drivers were beaten and were asked, why didn't you meet your quota of bricks yesterday or today as before? Then the Israelite foreman went and appealed to Pharaoh, why have you treated your servants this way? Your servants are given no straw, yet we're told, make bricks. Your servants are being beaten, but the fault is with your own people. Pharaoh said, lazy, that's what you are, lazy. That's why you keep saying, let us go and sacrifice to the Lord. Now get to work. You will not be given any straw, yet you must produce your full quota of bricks. This is a very powerful picture of the desperate situation that the Israelites were in. They were helpless. They were at the mercy of an oppressive regime. They had no power. They were completely oppressed. The way that bricks were made in Egypt in those days were you take clay, you would soak the clay with water, and then you'd mix in some straw, and then you'd shape it. Some of them were done by hand, some of them were done with boards, and then they were left to dry in the sun. And it made a strong brick, and that's the work that the people were doing in making these bricks in those days. Pharaoh's strategy, again, it's the standard strategy of a tyrant. He shifts the blame for what has happened onto the people. He says, the real problem isn't that you are oppressed. The real problem isn't that you have to do this work. The real problem is that you're lazy. It's your fault. That's why this has happened to you. Standard oppressors. Technique. And so he increases the physical demands on them so they wouldn't have energy for rebellion. And then he uses those who are willing to collaborate with him to divide the people. You take a few people who you offer a little bit extra to, a bit of authority, a bit of freedom, and say, come and work for me. And you use those people then to oppress their own people, to divide and rule. It's a well-known mechanism, technique. Now, I want you to imagine now. Use your imaginations. Imagine that you are Israelites. Think yourself back now into this situation. For some of you, in the cultures that you come from, there'll be things within your own culture that can enrich your imagining here. Others of you, it's more difficult. But just imagine what it must be like, must have been like for them. Moses had come along. They were, do you remember those, at the end of chapter four, when they heard this, they believed the Lord was concerned about them, had seen their misery, they bowed down and worshipped. Imagine the excitement they felt, yeah? God's going to do it. God's going to do it. Moses is here. God's heard our prayers. And then the events as we've looked at them have taken place. So now they find themselves in a worse state than they were before, much worse state than they were before physically. Now having to go and collect the straw, still make all the bricks. What do you think they're thinking? What's going through their minds? How are they feeling? What's going on for them? What do you think? What do you feel? What do you imagine as you put yourself back in their situations?
Moses is a liar because it seems to be worse than when he started.
Yeah, as Moses led us up the garden path. Moses deceived us. Is Moses a liar? What else? Nita?
Doubting the outcome, what's going to happen?
Yeah, God said this, but is this really going to happen? Yeah. We don't see any evidence of that. We're going backwards, not forwards. What else? I'm sorry, say that again, Christine.
Questioning the timing because you think this is the time for it and then it's not happening.
So. Yeah, this is the time. God said I'm going to do this. It should have happened by now. Absolutely. Questioning the timing. What else? What are they going to be feeling? What are they feeling?
Despair.
Despair? Yeah? What else?
Anger towards God.
Anger. Yeah, anger towards God. Anger towards Moses. Anger towards Aaron. I think anger. Yeah. Just lots and lots of anger. What else? Yeah, bewilderment. Yeah, I mean, we didn't ask for this. This isn't our fault. This is so unfair. You know, this is Moses. Why are we being punished for what Moses has done? Yeah, what else?
Rebellion, trouble, confused.
Yeah, rebellion, trouble, confused. What else? I'm digging at this because this is really important, because we're going to come to us in a moment. I want to just think about them for the minute, but then we're going to take this to us. What else might they have been feeling?
Cross with Moses.
Cross.
Yeah, thinking he's making it all up,
yeah?
Instead of things getting better, things are getting worse.
Instead of things getting better, things are getting worse. Enough of this. I can imagine him shouting, enough of this. I've had enough of this God. I've had enough of this Moses.
Abandoned.
Yeah.
Abandoned.
Abandoned yet again.
There was a lot of mixed feelings with him, like some of the elders and Moses and some of the other people there. Just some thinking, yeah, you know, God's going to answer it, or this is part of the process of something, and you know what is happening, what isn't happening.
Okay, a lot of confusion, a lot of asking questions. Is this part of the process? What's going on here? I saw a hand here somewhere, Christine.
Yeah, they must still be focused. After all these years we've been praying, we think that he's answered us now. Man, look at what's happening. Does he even care?
Yeah. After all these years we've been praying, look at what's happened. Does God even care? Does God even care? Let's read the next few verses. Verse 19. The Israelite foremen realized they were in trouble when they were told, you're not to reduce the number of bricks required of you for each day. And when they left Pharaoh, they found Moses and Aaron waiting to meet them. And they said, may the Lord look upon you and judge you. You've made us a stench to Pharaoh and his officials. And you put a sword in their hand to kill us. The foreman and probably the people felt that Moses and Aaron should be punished for what they'd done. They'd taken this action, it had had dreadful consequences for the people. They should suffer because of this. May the Lord judge you for what you've done. You've made us a stench to Pharaoh. Now let's take a step back for a moment before we follow the story through and reflect on what's taking place here. When God spoke to Moses, the passage we've looked at already back in chapter 3, what did God say? I know, verse 19, that the king of Egypt will not let you go. Is there anything unclear about that? Is that a clear statement? I know that the king of Egypt will not let you go unless a mighty hand compels him. When we read that bit from the end of chapter 4, it's very clear. Aaron told them everything the Lord had said. Yeah? So God has said to Moses and Aaron, this is not going to work straight away. Moses and Aaron had said to the people, this is not going to work straight away. God has said, he will not let, the Pharaoh will not let the people go. So even if Moses had done exactly what God had told him to, Pharaoh's answer would have been, it would have been no. Pharaoh was always going to say no. The fact that Moses loused up may have made it worse, but the answer was always going to be no. God made this clear to Moses and Moses to the elders. You see, overturning this oppression was never going to be easy. But you see, walking in faith with God is never easy. We know the end of the story, don't we? For us as Christians. We know that a time is coming when we're going to be spending eternity with God in heaven. Amen? And we're going to have a new body, a new heaven, a new earth, perfect fellowship with God, everything made new. We're going to be free from sin. We're going to be free from difficulties. No more tears, no more pain, no more struggle. Amen?
Amen.
Is it going to happen now? No. Is there a journey between now and then?
Yes.
Is it going to be easy? You see, setting people free from oppression is never easy, and it was going to be costly. Setting you free from the oppression caused by your own sin and the oppression with Satan set against you was not easy, and it was costly. It involved Jesus coming into our world, Jesus dying on the cross, laying down his life so that you can be set free. And it took time. And it involved cost. I came across this quote this week. It's one of a couple of quotes I've got from this guy, one of the people that I've been reading during the week, a guy called Motia. He says this: when the word of God arrives in our hearts and lives, testings and trials come too, as God's appointed way for his children to grow. Listen to this again. When the word of God arrives in our hearts and lives, testings and trials come too, as God's appointed way for his children to grow. When God calls us, when God blesses us, when God gives us faith for a situation, there are always going to be difficulties following. It's a biblical principle. I could take you through it time and time again in the Old and New Testament and show you, but I don't want to do that this morning. The principle is here. God's word has come. Freedom is coming. You're going to be set free. You're going to go to Canaan, the land that I promised you. It's going to happen. You're going to see my mighty arm outstretched. But between here and there, there's a journey. And that journey is going to mean that your faith is going to be tested. You see, faith is meaningless until it's put to the test. What does it mean for... I'll pick on you again, Ismat, because you're faithfully sitting in the front row. What does it mean for Ismat to say, I've got faith that God's going to do this? It means nothing if God does it just then. That faith is only tested, it only becomes reality in the time between now and then, and in the difficulty of trusting and holding on to the faith. And that's how Ismat grows in his faith. That's how Ismat grows in his relationship with God. That's how he becomes a mature or a maturer Christian. You see the principle? It's exactly the same here. And God wasn't pulling the wool over their eyes. God said, this is what's going to happen. The trouble was, Moses didn't listen. The people didn't listen. They heard the end of the story. They didn't listen to what God was saying. So let's think about ourselves before we move on to the next bit of this story. Let's think about ourselves and ask the question, from what we've seen so far, from that end of chapter 4 through to where we've got almost at the end of chapter 5, for us today, starting 2008, those of us here in this room living in West London, what do we learn from this story for us? What are the principles for us to take away from this part of the story so far today? Hola.
You can't have testimonies without tests.
Hey, that is very... Did you hear that? You can't have testimonies without test.
And?
And? Oh, that's brilliant. I never heard that before. Is that original?
And the bigger the test, the bigger the testimony.
Hey, and the bigger the test, the bigger the testimony. Wow. That's fantastic. Very good. Do you want to preach next week?
We'll always have a battle as Christians. Because what the spirit wants, the flesh wants the opposite.
Yeah.
And we're always in conflict with
there,
each other.
There's always this battle for us as Christians, because what the spirit wants, the flesh doesn't want, and Satan doesn't want either. There is always this tension that is there. What else? Is Matt?
Always there are new lessons for us in the midst of troubles.
Yeah, in the midst of troubles, there are always new lessons and new depths for our faith to grow to overcome. Yes. Alex?
Yeah, we should also support our faith with endurance, perseverance, and determination.
I like that. We should always support our faith with endurance, perseverance, and
determination.
Very good.
We screw up as humans all the time, but God's plan can't be affected by our screw-ups. So even if we do make a major mistake from what God's originally told us, the plan can still happen,
yeah.
Still be put right.
Excellent.
Just a slightly longer journey.
We're going to pick that up in a moment. We always mess up as human beings, but God is not knocked off course by the things we get wrong. And we'll see that in just a few moments. Anything else? Lessons for today? Yes?
After going through a test, there's always a reward for us.
After we go through a test, there always is a reward for us. Yeah, Liz?
Resist the temptation to cut to the chase with God.
Yeah, I like that. Resist the temptation to cut to the chase with God. Because God's timing is for our best. God wants the best for us. Amen?
Amen.
So when there is a delay between God promising something and Him delivering it, for His word actually coming about in our lives, it's not because God doesn't care, it's not because He's off doing something else, it's because it's for our best. Amen?
Amen.
It might not feel like it at the time. I can say amen to that. It might not feel like it at the time. But when you look back, you see what God was doing. And often He says to us in advance, you know, this is where we're going, but we're not going to get, you know, there's a struggle between here and there. No testimonies without test. The bigger the test, the bigger the testimony. Anything else before we move on? Okay. Verse 22. Moses returned to the Lord and said, O Lord, why have you brought trouble upon this people? Is this why you sent me? Ever since I went to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he's brought trouble upon your people, and you've not rescued your people at all. Now there's a mixed bag here as we look at Moses' response. I mean, Moses could have just stormed off the scene. He could have said, I've had enough of this, I'm going back to Midian. Bitter, disappointed, twisted, he could have just stormed off. Some of you would have done that, wouldn't you? I mean, you know, there are seasons of my life I would have done that. Seasons of my life I have done that. I thought, blow this, I've had enough of this, I'm going over there. Yeah? But he didn't do that. So full credit to him for that. He did absolutely the right thing. He turned straight back to God. Because at the end of the day, brothers and sisters, there is nowhere else we can go. There are other places we think we can go, other places we can visit, but at the end of the day, the only place where we will find any help whatsoever, is going back to God. There isn't anywhere else. And it takes some people a long time to discover that. They wander about all over the place. But at the end of the day, you have to go back to God. So it's a good place to start. Saves a lot of time. So he returned to the Lord. And then he came out with the standard moans of human beings. I mean, how many times do you hear this? Why? Why me? And why did you let this bad thing happen to this good people? I mean, those are the archetypal moans of human beings, aren't they? Why? Why me? And why did this bad thing happen to this good person? Yeah? I mean, there are some others as well, but those are three of the standard moans that human beings have. But I tell you this, that in Moses turning back to God, he did the right thing. And God is big enough to hear our moans. God's big enough to hear our moans. He's big enough to hear your moans. And asking questions of God is never a bad thing. In fact, anything we address to God, it's far better addressing it to God than anywhere else. So actually turning back to God, it may be some of you, as you come into 2008, for some of you come into this year with excitement, awareness of God answering prayer, anticipation of what God is doing. For others of you, as you come into 2008, it is with difficulty. It is with disappointment. Maybe with some anger, with some frustration, with some questions. Why? Why? Why me? Why did this happen? And in this context and situation, you turn to God. There is nowhere else to go with your questions. You turn to God. Ask God your questions. And then I suggest you listen to God's answer. Because here it is. The Lord said to Moses, "Now you will see what I will do to Pharaoh. Because of my mighty hand, he will let them go. Because of my mighty hand, he will drive them out of this country." God also said to Moses, "I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty." That God Almighty, by the way, in Hebrew is El Shaddai. You know, in some of the songs we sing, we have El Shaddai. Well, it's God Almighty, and that's where it comes from. It's previously in Genesis, but it's there in Exodus. Revealed myself as God Almighty. "But by my name, the Lord," which is the name Yahweh, "I did not make myself known to them. I established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan where they lived as aliens. Moreover, I've heard the groanings of the Israelites whom the Egyptians are enslaving. I've remembered my covenant. Therefore, Moses, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord, I am Yahweh. I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people. I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. And I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hand to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am the Lord." The first thing we need to say, it's what was said earlier on. Even though Moses messed up, God was still in control. And here he reaffirmed his call to Moses. And he reassured him of the eventual outcome. The centerpiece is verse 7. "I will take you as my own people. I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God who brought you out from under the yoke." We can reframe that to describe our experience as Christians. See, God is willing to pay the price to set his people free. We see it here in the Old Testament, setting his people free from Egypt. It's a type, a shadow, a symbol of what was to come with Jesus. The paying of a price for setting people free, people just like us. Again, for the second of three times, to quote Motia today. Verse 4, "The Lord keeps his word." Verse 5, "The Lord feels our woes." Verse 6, "The Lord sets us free." Verse 6 and 7, "The Lord brings us close to himself." And verse 8, "He will eventually lead us home." Amen? Amen. And that should be our testimony this morning. Whatever your life circumstance, whatever it is, This is true for you. God keeps his word. God feels your pain. God sets you free. God brings you close to himself. And God is going to lead you home. Amen.
Amen.
Whatever you're feeling, whatever your situation, whatever your circumstances, this is the reality. But you might want to notice something that God didn't do here. He didn't answer a single one of Moses' questions. I've noticed that with God. All I can, you know, over the years I must have asked God, well, I've lost count, beyond counting the number of questions I've asked God. Sometimes I've been really cross and I've asked God questions. Sometimes I've just been confused and asked God questions. But you know, so often God's not answered my questions. All of that stuff that happened to Job. Do you remember the story of Job? He lost everything. And then got all his friends coming along to help him, in inverted commas. And then Job speaks to God. Does God answer one of his questions? Not at all. God says, I'm God. And there's a principle here. It's about living by faith. You see, if you had all the answers, you wouldn't need faith. In fact, it's slightly more complex than that, because if God answered our questions, most of the time I don't think we'd understand the answers. You know, we ask God why. If God told us why, do you think we'd understand it? You see, when we ask why, we've got this narrow focus just about me. God, why is this happening to me? Well, the answer is probably to do with my place in the universe. It's not because I happened to get out of bed the wrong side this morning, but actually it involves all these other people and all these other plans of God and all this other stuff that God is doing as he's working in history. And it involves all sorts of other people and all sorts of other destinies. And by the time God has answered the question, I'm not sure I'd understand it anymore. Are you with me? And so we have to, as one of the other people I read this week, Guy Dunham, says, we have to live the questions. We have to live the questions. I mean, I sometimes hear people saying, you know, when I get to heaven, I've heard this so many times, when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask God. Let me tell you something. If I understand the Bible right, when you get to heaven, you're going to be so enthralled with God, you will have forgotten the questions. You'll never know. I mean, I got a stack, you know, and if Joan was here, she's on holiday at the moment, I mean, she's told me, she's got a stack that's like this. You probably got some as well. You've got to live with the questions. That's what faith is about. It's living with the questions. Living with the questions. And trusting God. Trusting God. I mean, sometimes as our own personal story walks on, we can understand why God did this or why this happened, or at least some part of it. I don't think we ever understand the whole picture, but we can see a bit more of it. As Moses would have done, as he looked back after they'd come out of the land of Egypt. Maybe as he stood on the verge of the people going into the promised land. Moses never made it, by the way. We'll see that later on. He never got into the promised land. But he understood a lot more. But he had to live with the questions. Live with the questions. Verse 9. So Moses reported this to the people. But they didn't listen to him because of their discouragement and cruel bondage. The Lord said to Moses, go tell Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to let the Israelites out of this country. But Moses said to the Lord, if the Israelites will not listen to me, why should Pharaoh listen to me since I speak with faltering lips. There's a parable that Jesus told. It's the parable of the sower. And you have this sower sowing seed, broadcasting seed. It's where the phrase broadcasting comes from. It's a way of sowing seed. So he'd be wearing a bag, like a big handbag type thing, shoulder bag, full of seed. And as he walked, he would take a handful of seed and he'd throw it like this out. Then after the seed had gone, the plough would come and the seed would be ploughed into the ground. But when you're throwing that seed, you don't see what's underneath. And the land in Palestine is very rocky. Very, very rocky. Lots of boulders, lots of big rocks. And sometimes some of that seed would end up sitting in shallow soil. And a bit of moisture comes and the seed would sprout up very, very quickly. But as soon as the heat started, it would die. It's a bit like that with the people of Israel. Moses comes along and says, God says this. They say, yes! Really excited. They worship God. The first bit of heat comes along, they don't want to listen to God anymore. Find people like that as well. Still today. Great enthusiasm. The moment the heat arrives, all evaporates. But we're here for the long haul. The Christian life is a marathon, not a sprint. I mean, there are sprint bits, but basically it's a marathon, not a sprint. It's about endurance and perseverance. And what was the other one?
Determination.
Determination. I knew there were three. Those are hallmarks of the Christian life. Let's go on. As we move towards the end, last few minutes. These were the heads of their families, Moses and Aaron. The sons of Reuben, the firstborn sons of Israel, were Hanok and Palu, Hezron and Carmi. These were the clans of Reuben. The sons of Simeon were Jemuel, Jamin, Ohad, Jachin, Zohar, and Shaul, the son of a Canaanite woman. These were the clans of Simeon. These were the names of the sons of Levi, according to their records, Gershon, Kohath, and Merari. Levi lived 137 years. The sons of Gershon by clans were Libni and Shimei. The sons of Kohath were Amram, Izhar, Hebron, and Uzziel. Kohath lived 133 years. The sons of Merari were Mahli and Mushi. These were the clans of Levi according to their records. Amram married his father's sister, Jochebed, who bore him Aaron and Moses. Amram lived 137 years. The sons of Izhar were Korath, Nepheg, and Zikri. The sons of Uzziel were Mishael, Elzaphan, and Sithri. Aaron married Elisheba, daughter of Aminadab, daughter of Nashon, and bore him Nadab and Abihu and Eleazar and Ithamar. The sons of Kohath were Asa, Elkanah, and Abiasaph. These were the Korahite clans. Eleazar, son of Aaron, married one of the daughters of Putiel, and she bore him Phinehas. These were the heads of the Levite families, clan by clan. In one corner, see it on the screen, ordinary human clay. In the other, superpower royalty. But this mere humanity had been commissioned by the Lord. Why is this genealogy here? It's showing where Moses and Aaron came from. And they were ordinary people. In their genealogy, they would have been indistinguishable from everybody else. Just like you. Just like me. But God called them. In one corner, ordinary people. In the other, Pharaoh and all his power and might. But these ordinary people have been commissioned by God. So let's pull together the things from this morning. In the last 4 minutes that we have. What have we learnt this morning? What are the main things we take away from this passage this morning into this new year? I was trying to decide whether you had an itch or whether you were going to speak.
Okay, we all go through trials and tests, and all these problems do have their sell-by date. in the course of the journey, like Alex said, we all have to be, to persevere, to be determined, and
endure.
And continue to maintain a focus.
Okay, very good. I'm not going to try and repeat all of that. That was excellent. What else? Alex.
Looking at what we have just read, following God is not easy. Sometimes you may find yourself like Aaron and Moses, all alone.
Mm.
Not that Pharaoh rejected them, but the people of Israel also were not convinced whether they were acting in the right direction. But in all things, we should make life choices, and we should act in wisdom based on God's word and then obeying God. Amen.
Okay, amen. Isaiah.
Following God is not easy, but it's even harder when you don't.
I like that. Following God's not easy, but it's even harder when we don't. Yes, Andy.
When you ask God for something, you have to follow his timing.
Yeah. When we ask God, we follow his timing, not ours.
We are just ordinary people, and we are normal vessels, and God can use anyone, even a little child, who's in submission and obedience to him, to bring out to what he wants to do in his timing for his glory.
Yeah, we're just ordinary people, but God can take hold of us. Vessels of clay, but within us is the Holy Spirit, as we were exploring on the Holy Spirit Day with the young people yesterday. Fantastic day. Four things that seem to me to be significant out of this passage, in addition to the things that you've said. We need to listen carefully to God. Because part of the trouble here was that Moses and the people hadn't listened. As people have been saying, walking in faith is never easy. God is in control even when we mess up. And we need to live with questions. Let me pray for you, then I want to make a comment about yesterday. Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we come to the end of this teaching session this morning. Father God, we thank you for your calling, that you take us, ordinary human beings, ordinary people, human clay, but you take hold of us, you call us, you commission us, you put your Holy Spirit inside us, and you make us something different. Father, we recognize that the walk with you, the journey with you, is at times difficult. When we hear your word, sometimes it's hard to get from here to there, but thank you that you are with us for the journey, and help us to have the determination, the endurance, the commitment, the patience, the faith that we need to go from here to there with you. In Jesus' name. And Father, as we start this 2006 together, after this first Sunday together, 2008, what was I saying 2006? 2008. No, it was 2007. It's 2008 together. I ask you to pour out your Spirit upon us today. That you will flood us and fill us with your Spirit this morning. That as many of us go back to work next week, tomorrow at the end of our Christmas and New Year break, we will go back with an anointing, an empowering, an enabling of your Spirit. That in this year we're going to make a difference for you. Not because of who we are, but because of who you are in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please sit down. 2006.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.